Welcome to New Game Plus. I'm Tim. I'm joined by Donald. How are you?
I am spoiled for choice, Tim. There are just so many Japanese just things to experience at the moment. We've just come off the back of Asia Pop Fest, which thank you all who all attended, Tim. And yeah, like I'm sure we all had a great time. It was an amazing time. But aside from that, just the Japanese video games that have come out this past 3 months from our continent have just been amazing.
Yeah, and with some Western developers dropping the ball a bit, especially with the facial animations.
This is my surprise face at Mass Effect Andromeda. I am acting surprised.
Yeah. It's interesting to see how much of a gap like the last Mass Effect game was and this current Mass Effect game.
You just needed some time to let it mellow after, especially after the kerfuffle that was the Mass Effect 3 ending.
Yes, yes. But at least we're going to be happy about the Japanese games all coming out and all being pretty good as well.
Yeah, we've got like Nier Automata, we have Zelda, you have Yakuza 0, you have Gravity Days, you have Nier, you have Nier Automata. One might say we are near deep in good Japanese gaming, hey?
Oh god, that
hurts. You laughed in the last take, Tim. There, like that.
Thanks. But not only, probably the Switch hardware itself is having a few issues, but the games itself.
The game itself.
Are doing very well.
The game itself. Yes, there are other games on the console, but like we're all there for the Zelda. Well, we do have what's called, we have Splatoon coming out soon, we have ARMS, we have Mario Kart 8 Deluxe. So there are games coming out for that, and with all the very Japanese style as well.
Yeah.
But for the moment, I'm very content with Zelda and all the other games too.
But in stark contrast, in this episode, we have a look at a Western game, which you have a look at.
Ghost Recon Wild. Lands. Can it hold up amongst all these awesome Japanese games? We'll find out towards the end of the episode, Tim.
But first, let's go into our first segment.
Now, Berserk fans, unite. We finally have another game since what, PlayStation 2 era?
PlayStation 2 and the Dreamcast, yeah. I believe. So, of course, like, premiere for the West.
So we have Berserk Band of the Hawk, which is the English version of the Japanese game, which came out, I want to say, October last year, when we left. So
not long. It's just because it's not a full dub. Yeah. We just got the sub edition, so it only usually takes them about 6 months.
Yeah. And it is a Musou game. Let's just clear that out now. Berserk Musou is what it's called in Japan, and it is Berserk Musou.
Yeah.
They're trying to hide that a little bit, I think, with the name.
In the West, they tend to, like, you know, Ken's Rage. Yeah, that didn't have Musou in the title either. Like, basically, it's a very traditional Musou game. Yeah. It's one of the more straightforward ones in a while. It has its gimmicks, but it plays it pretty straight.
Even for a Musou game, like, even compared to, you know, we've had so many different variations now. Like, we can use Hyrule as an example. Yeah. We can use all these fanciful ones as an example. And this plays it like Zhaohu Dun from Number 3. Yeah. Like, you know, it just plays it super straight. And for better or worse, it plays it straight. Everyone feels different. Like, Gut feels like Gut. Big, meaty swings. You know, everyone else has their little, like, rapid attacks.
Like, Griffith even manages to bring it, like, and good on him. But, I mean, there's one thing that I think fans walking into this are going to have to really, really take to heart. And that's that, like most Musou games, it's based on the anime.
Yes.
It's not based on the manga. So if you're hoping that we're going to be stuck on a boat for the majority of the game,
What boat?
No spoilers.
Yeah.
But basically, it's using a lot of footage from the movie versions.
They look nice for CG animation.
And there's a surprising amount of footage on top of that. A ton of footage. That means Golden Age arc. And that's it. Yeah. Like, you're only going to get up to
it goes a little bit beyond the Golden Age. We get past Kasker and Femto.
That's right. And we get into the Berserk armor. It'll please certain fans on that front. But you have to understand that it is going to focus on what the anime did. It's retreading a lot of ground. And on top of that, it's the first game in the series. And most new Musou franchises tend to focus on the main character for the first game almost exclusively.
And then spin it off kind of.
And then, future games will be what ifs or spin offs or whatever. So, like, as a game, it's limited in what it covers, it's limited in how it covers it, being mostly Guts. It's a very traditional Musou game. So, I think a lot of casual fans of the manga are going to come in and really not get what they were hoping for, because they were hoping for, yay, I get to live.
If you're coming off AOT, It's very different AOT in that AOT specifically broke the formula to deliver the game that it wanted to deliver. And AOT was one of the best anime games in many years.
Mm-hmm.
This is still very good, but to me, it doesn't quite reach those peaks, and I'm hoping that that changes.
Yeah, like I feel like this is a game that was very much meant to appeal to Musou fans as opposed to...
Vice versa.
Yeah, and like, you know, it's worth checking out, and...
You get to see guts and like chops.
And Femto made it through, so...
Classification board, come at me.
So Dynasty Warriors has always had a strange relationship with strategy. It was originally the Romance of the Three Kingdoms games, a political strategy game, and Dynasty Warriors was the action spin-off to that. Now, let's focus on the action spin-off. Like, it was a fighting game, and then it was a hack and slash game that pretty much defined the genre. Since then, we've had lots of iterations of the Dynasty Warriors games that sort of take tiptoe steps back towards strategy elements. The Empires game introduces politics and maps to it. And then we had a Dynasty Warriors Tactics game, which was sort of an action strategy game. And like, while these were like pretty subtle about the ways that they did it, this game, Godseekers, is a straight out strategy game. Like there's really no other way to put it.
It's basically, you know, a grid-based, you know, you've got your units here, you're attacking other units on a grid base. It's all turn-based. It's a basic like turn-based strategy game. That's all you're getting. And that's probably the thing that is going to cut a few maybe of the Dynasty Warriors fans, because it doesn't do that much.
Yeah, like that's it. Like in terms of the ways that it incorporates Dynasty Warriors, like first of all, if you don't like the silly magic god aspect of the Dynasty Warriors games, you're going to have trouble with it, because this game focuses on a magical being who can do a whole bunch of silly magic stuff. Now, if you like Musou Orochi or any of those games, yeah, that's fine. That's sort of the way they're going with it. But a lot of fans don't like that sort of thing. It also focuses on charge attacks and Musou and things like that as really fundamental mechanics in the ways that you take turns. For example, a charge attack in this game isn't a mash combo. It's basically doing several attacks within one turn and the way that they link those together, which it's interesting, but it is a very superficial way of approaching it. And ultimately, it means that most of the mechanics are just really straightforward strategy RPG mechanics.
Yeah, it's basically just conserving your energy, and then when you've got enough energy, attack.
Yeah,
it's like there's not much of a Dynasty Warriors kind of drawback to it, except maybe the characters, the story, but even then the stories,
It's a little bit silly. Like, it follows the basic events of the game, but like it's very much a spin-off, and it's very much
a spin-off of a spin-off.
A spin-off of a spin-off. Yeah. That's what it is. It is a little bit trite, so that's a bit unfortunate. That's it. I mean, as a game, it is fun. Like, I don't play many strategy games, but I still enjoyed it. I wish there was more action elements to it. I wish there was less silly magic to it. But I think as a Dynasty Warriors experience, it's still, you know, really competent and, yeah, definitely worth checking out.
There's at least one mashing thing.
There's one mashing thing?
Yeah.
Great.
Now, Jason, Wii Sports really sold the Wii remote, and Nintendo Land kind of sold the Wii U game patch.
It sold asymmetrical multiplayer that was never touched again.
Yep. What about 1-2 Switch and these Joy-Cons for the Nintendo Switch?
It makes me thirsty, and not metaphorically, like literally thirsty.
I wonder why.
I don't know why. I haven't quite figured it out. But
really milking this analogy, aren't you?
Yeah. but look, 1-2 Switch is interesting because what it tries to do is show off all of the features of both the past. So there is baseball, which touches on that thing. There's a few of the other modes which you can have multiplayers in and stuff like that. But I think a lot of it is to showcase the HD Rumble and do the similar stuff that the previous showcase games have done. The problem it faces is that it is somewhat scattershot. There's no rhyme or reason
to it. There is 28 mini games, and like there is no real clear direction other than here's some games that you can play with two people, except for the one game that can only be played by one person.
Yeah, and that's the baby one, so no one wants that in their right
Or
mind.
The hamburger one, which just makes for good Twitch fodder.
Yeah, so, I mean, it goes from gorilla to telephone. Like, this is the kind of level that we're talking, and I think the biggest problem you face is that it really doesn't tie in any way. Like, and the difficulty does ramp up. So, yeah, you've got Quick Draw and all these obvious ones.
Quick Draw is fun. Yeah.
It is, and even fake Quick Draws, even, like, once you get into that, it's pretty fun. And I think it still has value as a party game. I just don't think it has the longevity of something like Wii Bowling or Wii Baseball or even even like Mario Chase.
No, I see it as something like, say, Cards Against Humanity. The first couple of times it's great, as in people will cack themselves, like playing through Milk and the Twisting game and the Gorilla game and the Model game. But it has a very short life. Like, after a couple of times, the novelty will wear off and then it'll just gather dust. And this is close to a full price title in retail.
It's not quite a full price title, but it is close. And I think if it was 20, 30 bucks, people would go no wuckers. If it was 50 bucks, people go maybe. This is more than that if you buy it retail. And whether that's worth the value to you, your mileage may vary. For the evangelists, though, I think for the people like me who bought it on launch anyway, it doesn't matter. We were going to buy it no matter what.
It also depends on like your social crowd. If the crowd is into Cards and Humanity, into novelty, then yeah, sure.
And I think if they're drunk, it's going to help too.
Oh, definitely.
And these can withstand a bit of punishment. But yeah, it is one of those things. I think it'll be a packing title for Christmas, coming out with Mario or something like that. Whether it's worth your time, I mean, do you have any friends? Ask yourself and be honest. And wonder why you're thirsty. Are you like, I know I am.
All I know is I really feel for farmers now, having to do this all day long. Although I'm milking a lot better than you.
Now, the Switch is one of those hard concepts to sell. People think of it as a Zelda machine.
Yeah.
Even though you can buy Zelda on Wii U.
Yeah.
So Snipperclips comes along. Looks like one of those unique indie titles that might be enough to put it over the line.
It's very charming title. It's got that charm.
It's got colours, it owns its art style. But the thing they don't tell you is that it is 100% a friendship ruiner. Like, if you play this with Shane, and I mean, Shane's always pretty sad, he goes to like, warm, like Joy Division, Love Will Tear Us Apart sad in like 3 seconds. Because you do require a lot of cooperation.
Yeah, and you require a lot of good communication between the two players to understand what each wants to do.
Correct, and this is the problem you face. So, you know, everybody has their role to play. You know, you play one player is boring, but you can do it.
You can do it.
Set. Two players, three players, four players. Four players is brutal because everybody literally has their role they must play, and if they don't play it properly, everyone's
coordinating suffering. Four players.
And it's brutal. Yeah. As you saw on stream, which was no fun. And then two players is even tough because even though it's only two players, you still may need to have multiple cuts for these. So the premise is you start off with the two things, which are like round on one end and flat on the other, and you cut to the appropriate shape.
Yeah. So sometimes you need a shape to catch something. Sometimes you need to match something that's on the screen.
Yeah.
But yeah, you need to cut in precise kind of things to get the job done.
So you need to talk to them, and you can always reset, but that in itself can set off enough of a chain reaction.
Yeah.
If the puzzles aren't for you, there's like ice hockey mode and team deathmatch and stuff. But they're boring. The best part of this game is like realizing how stupid your friends are and how much you hate their guts and you wish they died. And I think that is probably the best review I can give of Snipperclips.
Also, they don't know the directions, which way to rotate is clockwise and things like that.
Yeah, saying clockwise to people used to work better, I think, but it doesn't work anymore. Oh, I just turned clockwise. What clocks do you fucking use? Like, anyway. Moral of the story, Snipperclips is a great launch title, reasonably priced. There's enough content here for you to stick your teeth into. Like, did you hate anyone coming at the end of it? I mean, we all hate Glia, but...
No, but after playing a bit with some people, it was like, no, that's not what I want you to do.
You're talking about Glia.
Fast RMX is an expansion for Fast Racing Neo, which originally appeared on the Wii U. We liked it back then. Jamie, do we like Fast RMX now?
I actually really dig it. Like, this is my first time playing for it. I'm like, I'm happy with the fact that there's a brand new future racing game. Like, holy crap, what happened? Where are they now? They're here.
Yeah, it is future. It is fast. It is a silky, smooth 60 frames per second, which is what you want in one of these kinds of games.
The future is fast, and that's what I really like, yes.
Yes, and like even throughout that speed as well, you get to notice all the intricate things in the environment, all the environmental traps, all the wide, varied designs of the course, all 50 of them.
I think the fact that I love is that I love the track design. I love the fact that it is just, it's simple at first, but then you realize there's a lot of shit going on and you're going really fast. So it feels like F-Zero. Like the fact that it is about the track design. And I really love that.
Yeah, you're going fast, it's silky smooth, and your car itself, it controls really tightly, even on the sideways Joy-Con controller.
It works really well. Like I love it. But what else about it do you love, Dom?
I like the multiplayer aspect of it too. Like, because like it is designed for the Switch's tabletop mode. You can get two people side by side, get to see some racing, and It holds up for the most part. There are some occasional moments where it will chug, but they're the exception rather than the rule.
And hell, there's even online play and there's more stuff coming to the game as free updates. Like, that's really cool.
Yeah, so like, if you're gonna go for a launch title, if you want to distract yourself from something other than Breath of the Wild, then Fast Aramex is a decent one. Yes, it's a launch title, so it doesn't aspire to be anything higher than that, but for what it does it pretty well.
The world is a scary place. Even here, in Numbani, we needed something to protect us. Enter the OR 15 defense bots. They took the old Edina model from the crisis and gave them a complete makeover. They kept us safe for a while. I was at the airport when Doomfist attacked. Poor bots, didn't stand a chance. Everyone else gave up on you, but I saw what you could be. So I rebuilt you, upgraded your programming, and gave you a heart.
New personality module installed. System rebooting. OR-15 online.
No, that's no good. Every great hero needs a real name. What about Orisa? I made you to be strong and brave. You still have a lot to learn. And you'll probably mess up sometimes. But I know you'll become the hero we need.
My name is Orisa. I will keep you safe. That is my primary function.
It's another quarter, which means another new Overwatch character, but much to the chagrin of Reddit, it wasn't a Terry Crews-voiced Doomfist.
I suppose so, but instead we do get a tank character that kind of mixes it up a bit. It looks like it's a bit different, and it's a relief not to have to play Reinhardt anymore.
Hey. As someone who used to main Reinhardt, why the hate?
I'm just very bored of Reinhardt. It's like, if I'm going to play a tank,
what do you mean? What's
play...
more, what's more fun than staying on the point and holding your shield up? That's just good Overwatch fundamentals right there.
I prefer to play Monkey and knock people off edges, and that's it.
You don't want to play as Korean esports lady?
No, not enough good skins.
Her Lunar New Year skin was pretty darn good. I paid real in-game currency for that, thank you very much.
I don't own it, though.
Well,
that's the problem.
Although, I wonder, who do you reckon does have the best Overwatch skins then? If we're going down this dark road, what about Tracer and her myriad awesome skins? Or Mercy, or the Mercy Witch skin, I think that was the one I actually may have just done some little fist pumps when I unlocked it.
Nah, the Winston Jungle Explorer skin. I like that one.
Yeah. Actually, the McCree, Riverboat skin, the one that makes him look like Red Dead Redemption. That's a pretty good one as well.
It's pretty good.
But like skins aside, there are also some changes coming in the next patch after this. To Lucio, he's become less of a stand in the middle and heal everyone. That healing aura has decreased. In exchange, his wall running has improved quite a fair bit, which means I will no longer be playing Lucio.
Mijo, what if you had your own country?
So, Matt, we may have missed out on Assassin's Creed last year, but Ubisoft needs their annual franchises, so here we are with Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon's Wildlands.
And I think the question is that there's a lot of Tom Clancy games at the moment that are worth our time, or sort of. Division, Siege, which is doing some pretty good rounds at the moment, is another entry in the Tom Clancy series worth your time?
And no.
Short answer, no.
No. We'll get into it in a second. Let's talk about the setting of this game. You are a bunch of Ghost Recon soldiers entering Bolivia to try and take down the drug cartel that has plagued that country.
Mm. And while you're in the middle of things, as you try to take down the big kahuna, you come across a lot of intel. You have to go through and learn about some of the targets you need to face as you climb up the ranks to actually pick off the big kingpins of the cartel. So this goes around, you run this massive open world environment of Bolivia, going through certain areas like mountains, cities, towns, trying to grab everything you can in order to kind of take down some big people, getting a whole massive variety of missions, using a lot of vehicles.
You say variety.
I say variety, but you're basically just going through all these different areas and open world environments and just trying to grab as much intel as you can, killing a lot of bad dudes along the way, and having some fun, hopefully, with three other people that you're playing
with. Yeah, that's the ideal scenario for Ghost Recon Wildlands, is that you and three other people are going around these various enemy clusters and just tactically eliminating them, like, 4x4x4. So, like, if you can get that very, very specific scenario together, then it's an okay experience. But if you're playing solo, then it's just monotonous because the AI, what soldiers that accompany you, they are overpowered, especially if you upgrade one or two abilities, which means that you can almost, it almost turns into an RTS of you just targeting soldiers and letting, targeting enemies rather, and letting your AI soldiers shoot them.
And it's a real dumbed down version as well. You still do have the gun porn as well as the sync shots from Future Soldier, which is a much better Ghost Recon game, by the way. But everything else, like, everyone just works far too efficiently and everything becomes monotonous because you're doing the exact same thing, going into an outpost Ubisoft game, liberating it and then getting
just,
out.
Just be thankful you don't have to climb towers in this game.
Yeah,
but that's thankfully. The thing with Wildlands is like the gameplay loop is very, very small and you're doing the same thing over and over and over again. There is very little variety to the missions or the gameplay or anything less
and
like that.
And the beauty is getting three other people together and making sure you're pulling off this perfect heist or this perfect mission. But the thing is, though, if you have AI components and AI companions, things, as you mentioned before, get pretty dry very quickly.
You could try online just by yourself and some random strangers, but these are internet strangers. They didn't have microphones, which you need for this game, which makes me question, like, who is this for? If you're playing this by yourself, then it's just completely mundane. If you're playing it online, it's completely, it's just completely dysfunctional. Mm. If you're playing this with four friends, it's fine. But Matt, is this worth four copies?
Not exactly, unfortunately. And when you're playing with AI, it becomes Ghost Recon Dialands.
More like Ghost Recon Mildlands.
That too.
The bar set for open world games is too damn high.
Too high. It's like, I was coming straight off the back of Breath of the Wild. So to go from that to Ghost Recon Wildlands was a hard swing. That is an open, like, Breath of the Wild is an open world, just filled with life and adventure. Wildlands is an open space where you're doing not much as you go from objective to objective.
Yeah, and we recently had Horizon Zero Dawn as well, and that's probably one of the better ones.
And that looks,
and that has come out since Witcher 3.
Yeah.
And let's be honest, Witcher 3.
And it looks well, if there was a digital trading card game in this one, but no. Yeah, that game looked good. Wildlands, it looks middling at best. But there's one thing I want to talk about in particular. It's just the mixed tone of Wildlands. Because, like, the game tries to go all Tom Clancy, so be super serious about the drug wars. And it tries to go a little bit America hurrah, with especially with one of the characters whose name might as well be Dude Bro McChloroform. And then it goes to be GTA funny with, with the radio DJ who's all weird and wacky and yeah, propaganda, yeah. It all just comes together and just ends up being all awful.
They need to just cause it. Like, just make it fun to be in that world. Parachute everywhere and do whatever you like.
Or go the other way and be completely Tom Clancy, yay, thick book serious and talk about geopolitical conflicts and the effect of the war on drugs and something like that. But instead, this seems like a game that was just market tested to bits. And in the end, we've just got these stray pieces, all badly, badly written, all badly voice acted too.
And it's so hard for a game to come out with that much competition and be rated well, because you're rating up against some very good stiff competition.
Although I reckon that even if this game was pushed a couple of months, I don't think it would rate any better.
That's it for this week. Please visit our website, www.newgameplus.tv.
Like us on Facebook, facebook.com/newgameplustv.
Follow Twitter and Instagram at newgameplustv.
And subscribe to us on Twitch and YouTube. We are newgameplustv, one word, no spaces.
Thank you, Donald.
Thank you, Tim.
We'll see you guys next week.